You're listening to Convenience Matters, brought to you by NACS. We'll talk about what we see at stores and what the future may hold for our industry.
The NACS show this year, there's a special advanced category management course that'll take a deep dive into the topic. We're not going to go as deep as that six-hour session that takes place adjacent to the NACS show, but we'll maybe dip our toes in the water and learn a little bit more about category management and what you need to know whether you attend this seminar or not. Joining us today for the conversation, we have two of the leaders of this category management seminar. Lucia Crater, she is Executive Vice President of Sales and Business Development, and Lisa Solaria, Senior Principal Consultant, both with Impact 21. So thank you both for joining us today.
Thank you.
So Lucia, let's start out with you. Big picture, category management, what do people think it is and where are they right and where are they wrong in terms of how does it all fit in terms of what you need to do?
Well, I believe that what people think about it evolves on a regular basis. In days gone by, it was just how do we get certain SKUs into the stores so that we can sell merchandise. But now it is just so much more than that and really requires a great deal of collaboration with other departments. For example, price book and accounting and demand planning, et cetera. So it's far more reaching within an organization than it ever was before. It's also more than just buying certain products to put in the store, but it's which ones perhaps will be the ones that have the highest take rates or which ones are going to appeal more to the shopper base at this particular time, et cetera. So more moving parts.
And it relates to adjacencies too, because you see from shopper insights that something sells with something else, and it may be a different category buyer, but you need to work together to understand how your products work together.
Absolutely. And one other thing I wanted to add was category management also intersects with loyalty and digital marketing, because that's also another piece of the pie that's a wealth of information for retailers to understand who is buying what with what and when, and what are the things that they can do to help influence that basket to grow.
So Lisa, do you have additional thoughts to that?
Yeah, I mean, shopper insights today really refers to understand the type of person that is coming into our stores. And, you know, we think about that in terms of traditional demographic profiles, but today we think about it more specifically about missions. What's driving a customer into our store can be similar across many different genres and demographics. But the more we understand how frequently they're coming in, what they're buying, what they're not buying, we can curate the best offering to really maximize the value of every single customer.
And Lucia, with customer insights, what are some of the ways that you can measure that are available, or particularly, are there specific metrics that people should be looking at?
In the convenience store industry, there's tremendous shopper insights that are available to retailers. First of all, their scan data is just a gold mine, telling them what's being sold, what's not being sold, et cetera. When that scan data is cross-referenced with some syndicated data, then that can help the retailer understand perhaps maybe if they're missing some products in their stores that are trending very well in the industry. Additionally, retailers can look at their loyalty data, which I mentioned earlier, which gets very precise into who's buying what and what is in the basket, et cetera. So retailers have a lot of data at their fingertips. Now, how they choose to use it is really up to them. And then finally, there's some outside sources of data. For example, NACS Convenience Voices which does mobile interviews for Shopper Insights at, as they say, the moment of truth, and talks to that consumer. So we are in a place right now where there's an enormous amount of data that retailers have access to and just need to use it to better understand the shopper.
Lisa, when we talk about looking at data, is there anything that you suggest that is more powerful, or is there a process in how one might look at data and then determine what is the best solution? We know there's a lot of data out there. I heard somebody use the phrase data obesity or something like that a few weeks ago to talk about, we have so much data out there and it's all good, but there's so much you don't even know where to start. So how do you advise people when they need to dive in a little deeper? What are the guardrails or what are the guidelines in how do you take advantage of data?
You know, that's a great question. And we tee up data quite a bit in the module Price and Promotion. And the way you start is you decide, what are you trying to accomplish? For example, if you're going into a promotion or you're trying to think about price changes, are you trying to drive units? Are you trying to build baskets? Are you trying to increase consumer frequency? And if you have those answers, then you can start to architect the type of data you want to extract from your various sources. One more to add is we talk about data quite a bit when we discuss promotional effectiveness. So when we think about, we spend a lot of time running promotions with signage and supply chain, how do we know it's successful? And the first thing we ask ourselves is, what were we trying to accomplish? And after we answer that, we can go source that data and make sure that we're looking at our promotional effectiveness from a holistic standpoint.
It's much harder. It's much harder than online, where you can tell the effectiveness of something when you just click on something and, you know, click through rate, you know, all these other things. It's a little tougher to say, did that pump topper signage promotion move somebody inside the store? And did that really result in the action? There are some ways to look at that. But short of standing there and watching customers, which would probably be a poor use of somebody's time and maybe a little bit creepy, but what are the ways, Lisa, that you can see if a promotion is effective, and then you can apply it to a broader category management structure?
Great question. I mean, the most traditional metrics most category managers are going to look at is, did I grow top line sales, units, and did I make more margin? Those are the easy ones. The more difficult ones are to dive a little bit deeper into basket data. So for example, by me aggressively pricing a certain product, did I grow the basket size? Another one may be, because I aggressively promoted a certain product, I want to understand specifically if I've changed consumer habit. And the only way you would measure that is what we call post-promotional stick. And that means you start to look at your sales and your unit movement after the promotion ended to see if you've actually changed consumer behavior. And those are just a couple examples.
I remember hearing a while ago, somebody said the hardest thing in retail is changing consumer behavior. So if you can do that, you're off to a pretty good start.
Absolutely.
Lucia, you talked about loyalty, and I saw a great quote in a book the other day. It said that customer loyalty in retail is the absence of something better, meaning that you have that customer until somebody figures out a better way to serve that customer. Do you find that that's a truism related to category management, or is that an oversimplification of how retail competition works?
Well, most data shows that your most loyal customers are also the ones that spend the most money in your stores, visit most frequently, et cetera. So it behooves the retailer to take very good care of them with perhaps specific offers or offers that hit their digital device when they go on site so that they know that this is something special for them. There are so many different loyalty programs that it would be easy to lose a customer because there are a lot of what I call shiny metal objects out there to grab people's attention. So it does behoove the retailer to take very good care of their most loyal customers. And the more personal the outreach can be, whether it's through a text message or something that goes to their email, if the consumer feels like they're being valued there, they will more than likely stay a loyal customer, but it cannot be taken for granted.
And the counter to that, Lisa, are there a couple things that you really want to avoid doing to so you don't alienate customers? Just a few no-nos that, boy, you really don't want to go down here as much as it sounds like it might be a nice test.
Well, I always go back to just the basics. And this may live a little bit outside of traditional category management, but, you know, customers expect excellent service. They expect expeditious service. They expect clean restrooms. They expect a core offering of products that are traditional across most convenience stores. So I think the key is know who your customer is, know who you're trying to attract in the future. But regardless of what is today and what is tomorrow, you have to execute on the basics.
And that is all the things you mentioned, clean bathrooms. Just start at the bottom. And we've seen that with consumer surveys. And then you get to things like food service and all these higher level things. But if somebody walks out of your bathroom and they've had a disappointing experience, they're not going to say, but I'm still hungry. They're going to leave and they probably won't come back. And then who knows, they may get online and tell everybody else about their experience. And that's certainly what you don't want. Lucia, you've been involved in category management for quite a while, been very engaged with NACS. Mm-hmm. Have there been a couple things that have fundamentally changed in terms of how you look at category management over the years, where it was one thing, now it's something else, or these are really things you need to stay on top of that you may not have thought about a couple of years ago?
So I think the basic block and tackling is still the same to Lisa's point. You know, do the basics, make sure that the products are in stock, they look appealing to the consumer, et cetera, et cetera. But the other thing for a category manager to keep in mind, and this is something that I don't remember us talking about years ago, was what are they doing and is it affecting any cannibalization in the particular category? So to Lisa's point earlier, I'm running a promotion. Hey, my units went up X and my sales went up Y and my promotional stick is up Z. But did I just hurt another product within that set? And so in the big picture, did I really gain anything? So it's become more of looking at what different levers retailers pull and then how it can positively or negatively affect whatever their goals happen to be that they're trying to accomplish.
And Lucia, I would imagine that that's also, how does it go back to what your brand is? If it's like Maverick, where your brand is adventure, and something doesn't feel adventurous, then well, maybe that's not the one you want to emphasize. If it's somebody like Buc-ee's, where a focus is on fun, then you have a different set of criteria for how do you measure what do we want to put on promotion and what do we want to highlight.
I also think that for category managers, it's a delicate balance. It's a great deal of art and science, I believe category management is. The science behind putting products and making them available that people that really like to buy them, but also what's new, what's upcoming, what can we gather more attention from people? What might they add to their basket because it's something new and maybe they haven't seen it in another channel of trade. So category managers have to balance both of those with the best interest of their different sets in mind.
So the NACS show, I think, has when there was this company that analyzed sales at shows, the NAC show would always come out as the top in terms of percentage of buyers, which is somebody who has the ability to affect purchasing decisions. So we have a high percentage of retailers who can affect buying decisions who will be at the show. Some of them will be in your category management seminar. Most will not be. Because we don't have a big enough room. What is something that you would advise somebody at the NAC show for the first time to think about doing? And I'll start with you on this one, Lisa. What might you want to do to get in the mindset to take advantage of both the education, the networking, and of course, this massive exposition?
That's a big question. So for somebody who's been going to NACS for over 20 years, one advice I would give is narrow down what you're trying to uncover. And what you're trying to investigate, it can be very large. And I think the more kind of surgical and the way you kind of path out your journey at NACS can always be very helpful. With that being said, I would just give some advice to keep an open set of eyes. To your earlier question, this is a very dynamic industry. And we have a very finite space to optimize our portfolio of products. We continue to have encroachment from other channels, whether it be dollar or drugstore. So there's this mindset of how do you really surgically manage and optimize all the products on your shelf? At the same time, how do you keep an open eye to new trends, what consumers may be interested in? And over time, can that become a way to really differentiate your brand? So a little bit of balance of both.
Lucia, have you also answer what's the best way for somebody to think about managing the NAC show when there's so many things going on?
In my opinion, NAC makes it very easy because they feature the cool new products area, which is generally very easily accessible to retailers by just scanning their badge. They can get information that they want, but it's all in one room in one spot that you can go through relatively quickly and find out what happens to be what we call cool new products. Additionally, recently NAC added the new to NAC pavilion. And so I would encourage all retailers to take a peek there. And those will be all the folks that have never exhibited before at the show and see what they have to offer there. And that makes it a whole lot easier than going through booth after booth to try to find those things. That isn't to say that current manufacturers won't have new products, but these will be new entrants into the convenience store or opportunities to enter in the convenience store all in one really very tight-knit, easy place to look at.
Lucia made a great point with the new to NAC exhibitors. The last couple of years, getting out of the trade show floor, I try to visit them and just say, hey, thanks. There's a lot of different trade shows where you could spend your money. You decided to try the convenience channel and registered early enough because of we sell out with booth space. The one thing I always notice is they go in with middling expectations. They really don't know what the NAC show is, and they don't really know our industry. And after talking to them, they're blown away that this is such a vibrant event. But I think there's also an opportunity for retailers that want to look at some of these companies as a partner in rolling something out. There's an education opportunity here because they make stuff and they think, well, we'll just go to grocery because that's a big footprint. We'll go to some other channel because it's easier to get 100 or 1,000 stores than it is to get some of the smaller chains. But real opportunity for retailers when you're reaching out to suppliers to have that two-way conversation. And if you make them smarter, they're going to find a way for their product to work in your stores.
Absolutely. And a partnership is really what it's all about. In my many years of being in the consumer product good industry, the retailers that really did want to partner were the ones with which our products were the most successful. So you're absolutely right.
So kind of summarizing things up, if Lisa, we'll start with you. What should somebody be doing? And we highlighted this a little bit, but two, three things right now that somebody should be thinking about doing differently with category management, whether they're able to or not, but just that big picture, and maybe on the plane, the strategy comes together a little bit more, but just big picture. How can somebody, even without going to this seminar, take advantage of some of the thinking?
Yeah, if I had to give you a couple, what I would call key takeaways from the course is, one, know who you are as a brand. Because ultimately, as a category manager, your role is to curate all these products and services to really differentiate your brand. So to your point earlier, are you a value brand? Are you a brand anchored in fresh? Are you a brand anchored in expeditious service with a lot of digital engagement? Are you a brand that's anchored in a just amazing shopping experience? Because ultimately, you're bringing that brand strategy to life through how you're pulling together these products and services under an ultimate value for the customer. The other thing I always stress in this class is a word I'll use. It's called portfolio management. And often what happens is we look at categories very siloed. We look at beverages, we look at tobacco, we look at fresh food. But really, all these categories come together and you position them differently. You pull different levers to create something that's very differentiating. So, no. Are you a trip driver in tobacco? Are you a trip driver in fountain? How do I express, you know, maybe a fresh halo through some of my fresh fruit and my produce offerings? But know that ultimately, you know, that 30,000 foot view is how do I bring all these products and services to really create something differentiating for my retail brand?
Lucia, same question for you. And I think what Lisa hit upon is something else that we've seen in our industry. Everyone largely sells the same items we do. Whether it's a clothing store, a auto repair store, whatever, they're selling 60% of our stuff at the register. So asking you the same question, but maybe just a little bit of a different spin, how can that also apply with some of these items that everybody has? How do you make these products talk to essentially say, you should get them from us, not from all the others, whether they're convenience or convenient?
More and more people are tied to products and companies that support a social mission or sustainability or both. And the newer generations, even more so than ever before, in many cases, they will put pricing aside to support a retailer or a product that does have a social mission. And that's very, very important to them. And that's one way that retailers can truly differentiate themselves. And the retailers who have are definitely reaping the benefits. Many, many retailers in the convenience store industry do an exceptional job with supporting their communities and charities, et cetera. And so continuing that message and that social mission could really help to elevate them in their communities as well as increase their sales.
It's a great way to end this episode. One of the things that we've seen in our consumer surveys is we ask people what would they do to save 3 cents, 5 cents, 10 cents a gallon. We find that just as many people would go out of their way, 5 minutes out of their way, to go to the store that cares about them than to save 5 cents a gallon. So I think that's a great way to wrap up this. And how do you look at the data? How do you look at what the customers are telling you, both in terms of what they want to buy and why they want to buy it? So looking forward to hearing about the success of this program at the NACS show. And I know it's going to be a full house, and looking forward to seeing you at the NACS show. And thank you for joining us today. And thank you all for listening to Convenience Matters.
Convenience Matters is brought to you by NACS and produced in partnership with Human Factor. For more information, visit convenience.org.